We say children can go to children's church if they'd like. They've been working through a program called Pee Wee Pirates, and they've been having a really good time with scripture memory and singing songs. And we've had some great help over there as well. So just so you know that that is available to you. And like I mentioned in the past, children are always welcome. We welcome anyone here. If they let me in the door, then anyone is welcome here at this church. Because we're all sinners saved by grace. Church is not going to fall down if a certain person walks in, or the walls aren't going to fall apart, or you know the church isn't going to throw them back out or anything. We're all sinners. We all need Jesus Christ's blood and sacrifice for us. It's our only hope. And sinners saved by grace. And that's what we're going to be reminded of this morning as we're going to be talking about the woman at the well here in John chapter 4. As you've just read this passage, we're going to be going through this passage, the first part of the story, really. And then the last part, of course, is almost as exciting as the first part, as we get to hear what happens from what is being shared in this story. We'll be talking about that next week. But it's interesting here, you know, starting in chapter 3, like if you guys remember, we have the discussion with Nicodemus. To kind of review a little bit, we have Nicodemus, we have John 3:16, which Jesus tells to Nicodemus, you know, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes on him should not perish but have everlasting life. And it's almost like John is starting off here with several personal experiences. Now, a lot of the other Gospels have, you know, different things that Jesus did, different actions. It kind of follows the story in a lot of different ways. John in his Gospel doesn't necessarily follow a chronological story, although I think a lot of the events are chronological that John is describing. But he kind of gets away from what some of the other Gospels are talking about, you know, different events and different things. Well, John describes them as well. John puts in a lot of personal experiences. And we've talked about that in the past in different sermons as well. The fact that personal experience is important to John. He describes himself as the disciple whom Jesus loved because he really appreciated, not because he thought he was the only one whom Jesus loved, but he was just amazed at the fact that Jesus loved him. He fully appreciated the fact that Jesus touched his life and wanted to be with him. And John, he's so excited about that. He goes through and he tells us of several different personal experiences here as he's opening his book. We start with Nicodemus in chapter 3. Now then chapter 4, we have the woman at the well. And then later on in chapter 4, we have the official son, chapter 5. We have several personal experiences here with Jesus Christ. One-on-one experiences, one-on-one interactions. And all, you have to think about it. I mean, here we start off with Nicodemus, who we established in previous weeks, as being a very educated individual. Probably someone who knew the Bible forwards and backwards, or the Old Testament, because of course in the Jewish culture at the time, would be at the top. He would be at the pinnacle of Jewish culture at the time. He would be the top guy. I mean, he'd have his face in the papers if it was modern day times. He'd be on TV all the time if it was just like today. And here is the next person is the woman at the well. The very next chapter, this he just continues right on through this dialogue. And here is probably the person who's at the absolute bottom of society. Not only is she a woman, which, of course, at that time, in Jewish culture, women were considered almost, not lesser human beings, but almost in a sense. Probably a lot of men consider that women didn't eat with the men. They had to serve the men first, and then they ate. There was just a lot of custom and culture. Women were degraded in a lot of ways. But not the fact that she was just a woman, which didn't gain much respect in educated circles at the time, but also the fact that she was a Samaritan, which we're going to see as well as we get into this passage, which made her even lower in Jewish culture. I mean, this is the very, very bottom. And probably for a Samaritan, she was probably at the bottom of the pile for that too. She was probably, for the Samaritans would have looked down on this woman, maybe spit at her, thrown rocks at her as she walked down the street. You know, maybe all kinds of cruel things to her. Absolutely hated her and despised her, used her. But here's Nicodemus at the top, and here is the woman at the well, as we're going to be talking about this week, at the very bottom. And then it just goes right from there, completely outside of Jewish culture, to this official son, who's probably a Gentile. And then we have the sick man later on in chapter 5. So we have very different individuals from all different kinds of extremes, all different parts of society. But it's interesting how Jesus deals with each and every one of those. He has a message for each and every one of those people. Sometimes we as people, we like to put people in groups. Now, have you ever met that? You can probably think of an individual right now. You know, it doesn't matter who it is or how long they've known somebody. They've got a little box for that person. I mean, they meet somebody, this person, they go in such and such box. And we're generalizing, we all generalize people. We're always make broad sweeps. Well, the people that live over there, they always do this. Or the people that look like this, they always do that. Or the people that believe these things, they always do that. Now, of course, we know, you don't have to live very long to know that with every generalization, there's exceptions, right? And Jesus deals with each of these individuals. He doesn't see them as a generalization. He doesn't look at Nicodemus and respect his position. He doesn't look at this woman at the well and say, you're at the bottom of the talking down to her. He deals with her in each and every one with a loving and equal way. You know, if there was somebody he could look down on, this it would be the woman at the well. I mean, almost the differences are night and day between Nicodemus and this woman. There's just such a contrast. And we have to remember that as we contextualize this passage and we go into this the scripture passage, we think about how Jesus is dealing with this woman, you know, here at the well. We're starting here in the beginning of John chapter 4, verse 1. Let's go ahead and look at verses 1 through 6. And therefore the Lord knew how the Pharisees had heard that Jesus had made and baptized more disciples than John, though Jesus himself baptized not, but his disciples. And he left Judea and departed again to Galilee. He must needs go through Samaria. And then cometh he to the city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near the parcel of ground that Jacob gave to his son, his son Joseph. Now Jacob's well was there. And Jesus, therefore, being wearied of his journey, sat on the well, and it was about the sixth hour. So this is late in the day. Now, they've been involved in a long journey. A lot of things have been happening. We've been talking about baptism and stuff. We talked about that a lot with John the Baptist last week and the importance of baptism. A lot of things have been happening. They've been very busy. They're now traveling to a different area. So Jesus has been traveling. It could be worn out for the day. You know, I think about myself, and after a long day, the last thing you want to do sometimes is see somebody else or deal with another problem or something like that. And I'm sure you're just the same. After you come in from a hard day's work, the last thing you want to deal with is a challenging person, which really we have to admit that this poor woman is probably a very challenging individual and gives him quite a few challenges, as we'll see as we go through this passage. But here's Jesus coming to the end of the day. You know, like I was saying as I'm leading up and kind of introducing this sermon, is the fact that Jesus reveals himself. That's what we're going to see as we go through this passage, through this discussion of Jesus here at the end of the day. Jesus is revealing himself. What is he revealing himself as? He's revealing himself as God. Now, this morning in Sunday school, we had a good crowd there this morning. It's really good. I'm so glad all you guys came. But we've been talking about this morning about the fact that Jesus is fully God and fully man. And somebody mentioned, what do the theologians say about that? Well, I don't know everything. I don't want to give you that impression. But it seems like to me, from what I understand of what theologians say, is they just have to admit that, the good ones anyways, have to admit, we don't understand it. They've got some big terms. Hypostatic union is one of them for that. Various other big theological terms to describe it, but they don't really understand it either. And we don't understand it. We can't understand how someone can be fully God and fully man at the same time. And we were trying to think about, well, what if he was more God than man, and what if he was more man than God? Some people in their theology try to emphasize one or the other. But we can't. Now, Jesus Christ was fully God, and he was fully man. And the best thing to admit, an orthodox doctrine, I believe, is just to say, we don't understand that. We can't understand it. That's just the way it is. It's a fact. And what John is highlighting here and through his gospel is the divinity of Jesus Christ. What we have a lot is we've been able to see a lot about the humanity of Jesus Christ, the love of Jesus Christ, the fact that he loved his mother, and things like that, as we saw in John chapter 2. And various human aspects of Jesus Christ. John is highlighting the divinity of Jesus Christ. He's saying Jesus was God. And what we're going to see in this passage is if Jesus tells this woman, not just that fact, I am God. You're looking right at him. And you know what? I think she had a surprised look on her face. Even after this whole discussion, I believe she did. So here is Jesus revealing himself to a lowly woman. And remember that this is, he's revealing himself as God. John chapter 8, as we're going to see later, verses 56 through 59, Jesus says it to the Jews, and again, they have no mistake, and this is going to highlight what she's, we have to remember this passage, and as we're going to see what Jesus says to this woman here at the well. Your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad. And then the Jews said unto him, art thou not 50 years old, and thou hast seen Abraham? Of course, we know he was probably 30 at the time, but they're saying, hey, you cannot be more than 50 years old. I mean, you just don't look like it. And you're saying you've seen Abraham who lived thousands of years ago? Jesus said unto him, verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was I am. Now in English, it doesn't really come through terribly clearly. We might almost mistake it as, what is Jesus saying here? But when you're dealing with the Aramaic or the Greek, dealing with that and the Jewish culture at the time, this came through perfectly clear. And how can we understand that? It's because in verse 59 it says they took up stones and they to cast at him, but Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple, going through the midst of them, and so passed them by. They recognized that Jesus was saying, "Hey, I am God." Okay, there's Abraham. I wasn't even born when I came into this. There is no beginning to Jesus Christ. I am. That's what he's identifying with. He's identifying with Jesus, with God saying to Moses, I am that I am. I am in perfect control. I am God, is what he's saying. And they did not mistake it. They didn't say, what is he saying here? I'm not sure. He might be saying that he's saying that he's God. No, they understood exactly what he said, and that's why they picked up stones immediately to stone him for blasphemy, because they did not believe what he said. So this is what Jesus is revealing himself as God Almighty. And here he is about to reveal himself as God to this woman. We've had Nicodemus in the last chapter, and now he's going to pick the absolute lowest of the cross. He's going to reveal himself. Jesus reveals himself by being at the right place at the right time. Like I was talking about earlier, here he is in the sixth hour, at the end of the day. But where is he? He's at the well. Again, we have to remember, what is the well? You know, I've learned a little bit about well digging, talking with Richard and various different people. But we live here in Stonyford. We live in a somewhat of a dry climate, probably very rocky ground. And you can imagine, without drills, digging a well at that time was an extremely challenging thing. And, you know, finding water, just like here in Stonyford, was probably just as difficult. So building a well was very important. There weren't a lot of wells, and specifically probably not a lot of wells that didn't dry up at a certain time of the year. This is a very dry climate, and a lot of wells probably were only seasonal. But here's a well that is gone, again, we're probably late into the summer when this passage takes place. There's a well. They're still drawing water from this. So there's not very many wells. Again, we have to remember, there's not very many wells. The well is a very important meeting place. Everybody comes there. We have to remember, at that time, you couldn't go inside your house and go to the faucet and turn on the water. Every morning, the woman of the house probably had to get up, grab herself a big, heavy jar, carry it to the well, collect the water for the day, and then carry it back. This was a daily thing. Now, of course, again, we have to remember the climate and the situation. Probably a very hot climate. As most of you do, you probably get up very early to get your work done before the heat of the day. And that was no exception for the women at the time. Most of them were probably up very early in the morning to go to the well, because they did not want to carry a very heavy pot at the end of the day in the heat of the day, which was probably the 6 hours what it was. So most of the women had probably already been to the well that morning. So here's this woman coming to the well by herself in the heat of the day. Probably will be there, because they're all inside of their houses or trying to stay cool. Remember, they didn't have air conditioning at that time. So you don't go running around the heat when you don't have to. But here she is. She's coming because probably nobody else is going to be out. She knows there's not going to be anybody else. But Jesus is at the right place at the right time. And sometimes that's all it takes for us. Sometimes we're so caught up and we're so in our busy schedules, and we're constantly trying to go through our daily planner and that, well, you know, you might fit in here, and I'll try to see if I can work with you on this at this time and things like that. But here's Jesus. He's taking time out of his day to be at the right place at the right time. And maybe sometimes for you, That's all it takes. You just need to be at the right place at the right time. And how do we do that? We have to listen to the Holy Spirit. We have to listen to the Holy Spirit's prompting. Like we were talking about this morning, you know, Jesus did. He laid aside his glory. Was he still God? Yes, he was still God. But he laid aside some of his divine abilities to become a man. And he did. He had to depend on the Holy Spirit, I believe, just like you and me, to know where to be at the right place at the right time. But here he is at the well. Just this one woman is going to be there. You know, whereas normally probably the women at the time would have come in a big group. You know what, if it was me and I was thinking, well, you know, what's a good time to reach this community? I probably would have picked the morning hours, when the women were all there in a big group and you could teach them all at once. But Jesus, no, he wanted to pick one individual. He cared about one person. And that's the person he was going to reach that day. And he knew that she would be there at that time. But specifically, the sixth hour. That's John. He highlights that specifically the sixth hour. A specific time of the day. It's important. That's why John wrote it down. And that's why Jesus was there at that time. Are we like Christ, willing to be used by God any way at any time? We're so busy serving God. Now, sometimes we're just so busy out there doing all these different things, but the Lord wants us to be at another place. You know, sometimes we're all about, well, what? How can we maximize the amount of people we can reach and all these different strategies and things? Well, maybe the Lord just wants us to rest in Him and obey Him. D.L. mentioned this in the past, but D.L. Moody was a fantastic evangelist. And he said it wasn't until later in life that he'd get up in the morning and say, God, what do you want me to do today? Not get up in the morning and say, hey, I could preach to these people and do this and do that. Yeah, these are all good things to do. D.L. Moody did a lot of good things before this. But when he finally said, hey, Lord, I'm the servant here. You're the general. And I'm going to ask you, in the morning, what do you want me to do today? That's the where we need to be in our relationship with God. And that's where Jesus Christ is. He's at the specific time and a specific place. Let's remember Peter, okay? Here's a guy, you know, again, very involved in preaching to the people, right? I mean, he's seen thousands of people by this time in the book of Acts chapter 10. He's seen thousands of miracles happen, thousands of people get saved. And God gives him specific new instructions to reach a different individual. And Peter doesn't appreciate these instructions. What does he get? He gets a vision in verse 19. While Peter thought on the vision, the Spirit said unto him, behold, three men seek thee. Arise, therefore, and get thee down, and go with them, doubting nothing, for I have sent them. And then Peter went down to the men which were sent from him. Now, finally he obeys, but there's a whole dialogue, a whole story here where Peter's just going, hey, I don't think I want to do this. This is not, these are the wrong people. These are the Gentiles. You know, we've got to be busy reaching the Jews for Jesus Christ. We've got to be busy doing all these different things. But he's struggling with the Lord telling him, hey, no, I want you to go and preach the gospel to Cornelius. Peter's saying, he's the wrong guy. You know, how many times have the Lord asks us, hey, I want you to share with that person. I want you to be a blessing with that person in your life. We're like, no, wait a minute, Lord. I mean, I could reach this guy over here, or I could maybe share the gospel with this person over here. But it's important to say, Lord, what do you want me to do? And why is that so important? Because you don't have to spend too much time doing door knocking or witnessing to other people to realize there are times when you walk up and you try to share the gospel with somebody and they are not receptive. They don't want to hear it. I remember trying to share the gospel with an individual at the park. We were walking around the park trying to talk to different people. And I remember saying, sir, you know, I'd like to share with you about a little bit about Jesus Christ and what he did on the cross for you. And he said, well, that's irrelevant. And I said, well, no, I believe it's very relevant, something you need to listen to. And I said, why do you believe that that's still irrelevant? He said, evolution. And he walked off. That was it. I didn't get a chance to say anything more to that gentleman. He was not receptive. But there are times where the Holy Spirit goes before us, touches a heart. And I believe the Holy Spirit was working in this woman's life. 2 days before this, she probably wouldn't have listened to Jesus Christ. But right at that time, right at that place, she was willing. Maybe it was because she was finally broken. Maybe it was because the Holy Spirit was working in her life. I don't know. We don't know. You know, she had a very rough life, as we're going to see later on. She went through a lot of struggles, a lot of abuse, a lot of terrible things. And been running, and the Lord finally broke her. And here's Jesus Christ to meet her at the bottom. Isn't that Jesus Christ for us? You know, I think this passage is especially special to me because I identify with this woman. I'm the chief of sinners. You know, I'm at the bottom. But Christ came and touched my life. And that's just to me, it's just so special. Jesus reveals himself to a specific person. We see here in the beginning of verse 7, he cometh out of, and there cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water, and Jesus saith unto her, give me to drink. Specific woman of Samaria. Now, there was a lot of women in Samaria at the time. There's a whole bunch of different kinds of people. If it was us looking through that crowd, we probably would have said, well, this is the one to reach, not that one. This is a very nice woman. The Lord might use her. No, but Jesus wanted to reach this woman at this time. He came to a specific person, specific time, specific person. It's interesting who it is. Again, it's not some elite person. He didn't go to the top person in Samaria, the most religiously educated person in Samaria. He didn't go, there are plenty of religious leaders who probably lived in Samaria at the time. He didn't go to them and try to talk to them. No, it's almost as if he went down to the deepest, darkest place in L.A., if you want to imagine that, L.A., Compton City, if you've ever been down there. Now it's just, he went to the deepest, darkest place and found the dirtiest, the rottenest person he could find. He went to touch them. And you know what? That's me. That's you this morning. He went to reveal himself to that individual. Specific person. Specific time. Specific person. You know what? Sometimes it's so hard to be able to listen to the Holy Spirit's promptings. We are so hard to it. Some of us think that we're mature spiritually. And we are sometimes the most resistant. And sometimes it takes a new believer to come along and say, hey, you know what the Lord's telling you to do? Why don't you just do it? Now, just simple obedience, simple childlike faith. Sometimes those of us that think we're mature in Jesus Christ, we want to overcomplicate things. We just want to, Lord, I mean, we got to weigh the decision here. I want to make this in my own wisdom, my own logic. I don't want to listen to the Lord on this one. Maybe there's something here this morning, the Lord's telling you, hey, I want you to deal with this, or I want you to talk to that specific person, or I want you to do this specific thing in your life. And you're resisting. But God wants you to use you. It can be so hard to the truth of God's Word, the promptings of God's Spirit. So hard to the needs that God sets before us. Sometimes that's just the Holy Spirit's prompting. Sometimes the Lord just brings a need into your awareness. That could be the Holy Spirit working in your life. Saying, that's the person I want you to touch. Maybe nobody else in the church notices that person in the community, but they're in desperate need. The Lord lays them on your heart. Why? Because you're the one to go touch their life. Don't call up me. I mean, do. I mean, it's important to go and have help, you know, tell me about different people, especially now while I'm new in this community. But maybe before you call me up or call up one of the other elders or something like that, think about, hey, maybe the Lord's putting this person on my heart for a reason. Because I'm supposed to be the one. Because maybe the pastor can't, maybe God can't use the pastor. Maybe he's hard. His heart is too hard this morning. He'll go witness to that person. Maybe it's you the Lord's working on. You know, be at the right place at the right time. Be willing to deal with a specific individual. It can be so hard to the truth of God's Word. We need to be aware of the needs that come into our life, and be willing to make the effort to change, to be involved. Now, Woodbine Willie was a pastor at the time of World War I. He served very distinguishedly as a chaplain in the British Army during World War I. Was a constant encouragement to the soldiers that he came in. He got shared with him numerous times. Just an amazing man of God. And then after the war, he came back. A lot of the men that he had through that time, a lot of them were Welsh, some of them were English, but he had developed relationships with all these different individuals through the course of the war. And a lot of them were Welsh. And after World War I, Wales got hit with a huge economic crisis to the point where people were not just struggling financially, they were literally starving to death. And Woodbine Willie was aware of these individuals. He met a lot of them. He would go and visit them in Wales, and he became aware of their desperate need. And finally, he's, you know, the stories just kind of kept piling up. And he said, finally, you know, this is God putting them upon my heart to try to deal with this, to try to see what I can do to help these people. I mean, people were killing themselves because they saw no financial future. Sometimes one young man actually killed himself because he felt that he was going to be a burden on his family, and that he would eat too much food and that the children wouldn't have enough food to eat. People were literally starving to death. This is right after World War I. And there was a brutal winter that year. There was not much coal production as normal. There wasn't enough to go around, and people were so poor, they couldn't even hardly buy food, much less the coal they needed to warm their houses for the winter. So people froze to death through the course of that winter. And so he felt like, this is God telling me. He was obedient to the Holy Spirit. And he went back to England, where people were doing actually pretty financially well. People were struggling as well there, but not nearly to the extent as in Ireland. In Wales. So he went back to England, and to a lot of the churches that he had ministered in and preached at, shared at. These people were very familiar who he was. Started sharing in these churches, saying, hey, there's a desperate need in Wales. This is right next door. We're not talking about some African country or some other place. This is right next door, right here. Now, these people are starving. Would you please be willing to give money for these people? It would just travel from train ride to train ride, from church to church, asking with everything he had for these people. Just give anything you possibly can, whether it's even just food for these people. They're literally starving. Not just financial need, they're literally starving. And he was met with such hardness, church after church. After church, people refused to give anything. Finally, he wrote towards the end of this this time where he was trying to do this fundraising, he wrote this poem. It says, when Jesus came to Golgotha, they hanged him on a tree. They drove great nails through hands and feet and made a Calvary. They crowned him with a crown of thorns. Red were the wounds were deep and deep. For those were crude and cruel days, human flesh was cheap. When Jesus came to Birmingham, they simply passed him by. They never hurt a hair of him. They only let him die. For men to grow more tender, they would not give him pain. They just passed him down the street and left him in the rain. Prominent Christians, they refused to do anything. William Willie actually gave his life. He actually died. In the process of this, trying to do this fundraiser, he was in bad health to begin with, and all that traveling and speaking, he finally gave out. And he gave his life for those people. But he made a promise. He said, I will do what I can to bring back help for you guys. And he was unable to because people were so stingy. Be willing to listen to the Lord's promptings. Like I said earlier, there's probably something that's coming to your mind this morning. The Holy Spirit saying, this is the need I want you to deal with. This is the person I want you to affect. This is the thing I want you to work on in your life, but you refuse to listen. I refuse to listen. It says in Romans chapter 5, verse 7, for scarcely for a righteous man will one die. Yet peradventure for a good man, some will even dare to die. Verse 8 says, but God commendeth his love toward us, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. While we were that prostitute, while we were that woman struggling, abused, neglected, Jesus Christ looked down on us and said, I want to die on the cross for that person. Much more now being justified by his blood, we are saved from wrath through him. Jesus reveals himself by breaking cultural barriers. Right place, right time. Now he's willing to break cultural barriers to deal with this woman. What does he do? He asked her for a drink. Now today, that probably doesn't seem like much, especially in a dry climate like that. You know, here he's tired, it's the end of the day. It would be natural to ask for a drink. But at that time in that culture, a Jewish rabbi asking a Samaritan woman, probably this specific Samaritan woman even more so, was just an absolute no-no. You know, a rabbi at the time would have let himself die of thirst before he asked a Samaritan woman to pull water for him. They absolutely hated these people, the Jews in Jesus' culture. This was a cultural no-no. I mean, this is something you would never do. This is breaking the cultural barriers, breaking with a cultural norm. Well, what's politically correct? This was definitely breaking that. It would be almost like in America at one time where African Americans were looked down on, and so much so to the point where somebody would be spending time with them and helping them, and people like KKK and other things would come along and persecute them. And that's like almost the situation, or even, almost even more extreme than that kind of thing. He was willing to break cultural barriers to reach this woman. He asked her for a drink. And again, this surprises her. She knows the situation. She knows exactly who he is. She knows he's a Jewish rabbi. He hasn't even hardly said anything, but by his clothes, she knows exactly who he is. She knows that there's just no way in the world that he would ask her for a drink. But she's surprised as well. Continuing on, verse 8, it says, "For some of his disciples were gone away into the city to buy meat." Those were the natural people to ask for a drink, to maybe draw some water for you. But they're not there. "Then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, How is it that thou, being a Jew," she's like, hey, wait a minute here, "you're a Jew, asks me to drink of me, which I am a woman of Samaria, for the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans." She's saying, hey, you know the rules here, buddy. Why are you asking me for a drink? What's wrong with you? Jesus is willing to break the cultural barriers to reach this woman. Are we willing to do anything it takes to preach the gospel to somebody else? And follow Jesus' footsteps. And sometimes we're willing, hey, well, Lord, how many of you have ever sat there in the plane and you're thinking, the Lord's telling you, you know, whoever comes in and sits down, I still am now because I get to take kids with me, but usually people don't sit next to me because I got all these kids around me, my wife and various different things, but used to be when I was single and flying, I'd sit there, I'd get in the plane usually early, and I'd be sitting there and there'd be a seat, you know, sometimes on either side of me or just one, and I'd be thinking, well, you know, the Lord's telling me, hey, I want you to share Christ with whoever comes in. And you're watching these people walk down the aisle and you're thinking, okay, yeah, I can share Christ with that individual. They look nice. And then this hairy, gorilla-looking guy, you know, with tattoos and earrings and everything walks up and you're like, oh, man, I hope he doesn't sit next to me. I don't want to have to share Christ with him. How many of you ever done that? You know, you look through, these individuals are walking through, and oh, I don't want to share with that person. Jesus is willing to preach the word to any person. Doesn't matter who they are, what they look like. And for if there was anyone who looked the lowest, it would be this woman. In our culture, if she lived today in our culture, she'd be the last person we'd be out preaching the gospel to. Jesus Christ is reaching her. Jesus reveals himself by offering everlasting water, everlasting life, which their father Jacob could not do. Let's look at verses 10 through 15 here. And Jesus answered and said unto her, "If thou knewest the gift of God, who is it that saith unto thee, Give me to drink? Thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water." He's saying, hey, I can give you living water. You're the one that needs to be asking me for a drink. I just ask you that to wake you up. Yes, I'm thirsty. I do need a drink. But I want you to understand there's something way more important than the water that's in that well that I cannot reach at this time. There's no pumps in those days. No taps. You had to actually lower something down to pull the water out. The woman saith unto him, "Sir, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well is deep." She's pointing out the facts here. She's saying, hey, wait a minute here. You're offering me water, and there's just no way you can get it. I'd like to see you climb down there and get that water on your own without anything to draw. You don't even have anything to draw it with. You can't even get it back up here. "From whence thou hast living water? Art thou greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well and drank thereof, himself and his children and his cattle?" Now this was a very important thing to them. The Jews probably believed that Samaritans just were completely irreligious in entirety, but they were very religious. They had a lot of their own religious customs and traditions. One of them was this well. This was a very important well. This was for them, you know, you have to remember the Jews were like, hey, we're children of Israel, we're children of Jacob. But those Samaritans, you know, they're kind of mixed breeds. They're an impure race. They're not. So for the Samaritans, it was very important to have this well here because it reminded them, yes, we are the children of Israel. We are the children of Jacob. This makes us special. This is a special place. And here's Jesus challenging that special place, saying, hey, I'm bigger than this. I'm greater than that. And for them, this would have been a huge connection, a very special, honorable place. This is reminding them, we are children of Jacob. And he gave us this water. He gave us this water. He didn't dig this well down there in Judea where all the Jews live. He gave it to us Samaritans. She's saying, hey, are you greater than Jacob? What are you saying here? Jesus answered, continue here. Well, he is. Let's establish that. Chapter 11, verse 25, Jesus saith unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. Jesus is greater. That's what he's about to reveal to her. He's God. He's the one that made Jacob. And put him in this place to dig this well. He's much greater. And the living water that Jesus Christ has to offer is eternal life. We here living in a dry climate, especially with fires now going on around us, we remember that water is a very precious resource. You don't have to talk to too many of the ranchers around here to remember that. It's a very precious resource in a dry climate. And without it, you die. Period. You don't last too long without water. 3 days, maybe a little bit longer, but that's about it. So it's life-giving. What Jesus is saying is, hey, I've got something that lasts beyond 3 days. This is eternal life. I've got the life that I can give you. So Jesus reveals himself by breaking cultural barriers. Jesus reveals himself by touching her heart's deepest longings. Let's look at verses 16 now. 16 now through 18. Jesus saith unto her, he said, verse 14, let's go to 15. The woman saith unto him, sir, give me this water, but I thirst not, neither come hither to draw. She's thinking, hey, I don't have to carry my pot here anymore. This sounds really good. Now, this is a lot of work. This sounds really good. Jesus saith unto her, go and call the husband and come hither. He knew exactly what the next thing, where to go from here. It seems like if this was me, I'd say, she's willing to listen, right? Let's sit down. Let's pray the prayer. But Jesus knows there's still obstacles that he has to overcome. And the greatest one is, where's her love? And for this woman, the question of what is love would have been a very hard question for this woman, as we're about to find out. Continuing here in verse 17. And this woman answered and said, I have no husband. She didn't want to deal with this topic. This was a very, very hard topic for her. This was the topic, if you understand what I mean. This was the topic that, no, Jesus, you can deal with a lot of different things, but this is one where you're going to hit a closed door. This is an area where there's too much pain. This is an area where there's too much challenge. This is an area where there's too much hate. There's too much bitterness. It's too dark. It's too black. We cannot walk into this room. I don't have a husband. She lies to him. And Jesus said unto her, thou hast well said. I have no husband. Thou hast had five husbands, and he whom thou hast is not thy husband. And it's in that saidest thou truly. Now here's a woman, she probably lived a life of abuse. I mean, today in our modern country, we have ways for women to escape situations like that, but at that time, the men were the primary breadwinners. A woman had almost no way to support herself financially. If she was out on the street, she would probably literally starve. There was no option of, let me just leave this guy and start get a better job and support myself or whatever. There was no option for a woman at that time. You had to be married. And probably for this woman, she's older. She's been through five husbands. Actually, she's on her sixth man. And this guy didn't even marry her. He was just living with her. These men had abused her all her life. She's probably older. She wasn't as good looking as she was at one time. You want women to understand this. And the man had probably gotten worse and worse in her life. Each one was probably successively worse. She had no concept what love is, or what love would mean. She was so far from it. Her well in this area was so dry. It was just dust at the bottom. And Jesus was about to pour water into that well. This is her greatest hurt, her greatest longing. She's been spending her entire life looking for someone who would love her, cherish her, take care of her, honor, respect her. She had never had that probably through the entire course of her life. For her to leave the first husband would probably have been a very gutsy move. She would have only done that in the extremest of circumstances. But her to leave a second and a third and a fourth and a fifth would be even more. And again, suggests how dire her need was. Not just financially, but physically as well, in every way. And Jesus wants to reach down in that deep, dark pit and grab the hand of that little individual who's suffering there, who thinks there's nowhere else to go, and pull her out. Galatians chapter 5, verse 22, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace. First thing, love. We want to understand love. We've got to touch the heart of God. God loves us more than anything else. And He loved that woman there like she had never, ever been loved in her entire life. We're about ready to find out what true love is. Jesus reveals Himself through the meaning of true worship. Let's again look at verse 19. The woman said it to her again. He doesn't want to deal with this issue. Let's talk about something spiritual. Yeah, that's great. It's interesting to talk about something spiritual. But I don't want to deal with what's really in my heart. This is way too painful of a topic. This is way too dark of a room to open the door to. The woman said unto him, Sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. Our father worshipped on this mountain. You say in Jerusalem, this is the place where men ought to worship. You don't have to go witnessing too many times to hit this dodge. And Jesus knew just what to do. She's, hey, what about worship? Let's talk about that. And Jesus is like, well, let's talk about worship. What does he say here in verse 21? Jesus said unto her, Woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor at Jerusalem worship the Father. Ye worship, ye know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour cometh, and now is, that when the true worshiper shall worship the Father in spirit and truth, the Father seeketh such to worship Him. What Jesus is saying is, hey, salvation is right now. God is working through the Jewish nation. You have to become a Jew to be saved. And Jesus is saying, hey, there's coming a time. That's going to no longer be true. Anyone, Gentiles, can be saved. All you have to be is a true worshiper of God. What does it mean to worship God? What does it mean to worship something? It means to fear it, to respect it, to honor it, to praise it, to glorify it, to love it. What you love is what you worship. No question about that. And that's what God wants. That's what God wants of us. I want your worship. That's what He wanted of this woman. Hey, you want to understand love? Start to worship me. You're going to understand love. I will show you what love is. God is a spirit, and they that worship Him must worship Him in spirit. Because we're talking about a spiritual world here. It's no longer about the Jews and the Samaritans and all this division and things like that. It's about the spiritual world. It's no longer what color you are or what side of the fence you grew up on, what side of the tracks you grew up on, or what you look like or what you believe. It's about whether you're involved in the spiritual world of worshiping God as a spirit. So then she says to him, this is the question. And I think this is almost the question that Jesus has been asking her to ask the entire time. She saith unto him, I know that the Messiah cometh, which is called Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things. She brings up that topic. Hey, there's all these different arguments. She's kind of bringing up, okay, well, you're a Jew, and this is where you stand, and this is where us Samaritans stand. We've got our well here. This is important to us as well. But then she finally says, hey, the Messiah is coming for all of us. This is the important thing here. This is what unifies us together, actually. This is the first thing that she brings up that actually does unify the two of them. Because as Jews, as sons of Jacob, that's what they would be looking for, the Messiah. God on earth. They knew, and they had a clear understanding of what the Messiah would be, who He would be, what He would do. He would liberate us. They're saying, hey, we do have something in common. This is, what about the Messiah? And this is where Jesus said, blows her away. He says in verse 26, he says unto her, I that speak unto thee and me, I'm the one. I am that I am. I'm God. And all those problems that we've touched on, that you want to stay away from, that you want to dodge, that you want to do anything you can to just shut that up and forget it, that it ever existed, that's where I want to reach into your heart and change you right there. That's where I'm going to start. That's where God wants to start. He doesn't want us, you know, a lot of times we come to church and we're like, oh yeah, I'm happy to work on this problem. I'm happy to work through that theological difference and this and that. But then when it comes to our deepest, darkest thing in our heart, no, God, you can't come there. You can't touch that area of my life. I don't want you dealing with that part of my life. That's what God wants you to deal with. That's where he's going to start this morning. He's not going to deal with all these outer, exterior things. He's going to go straight to the heart of the matter, and that's exactly what he did with this woman. I'm the answer right here, is what Jesus is saying to her. You've looked everywhere else, and all you've been met with is pain after pain after pain. But I'm the answer. You look to me, I'm going to change your life. And you're no longer going to be at the bottom of this town. You're going to be the one that's going to bring the whole town to me. As we're going to see in this next passage. They're all going to come. The whole town, whole village is going to come to Jesus Christ. I mean, wow, what an opportunity, man. If you knew the key person in this community, we're in the whole town. Man, that's pretty amazing. But you know, the day before, they didn't care about this woman. They spit on her. They probably threw rocks at her when they saw her. They rejected her in every way. And then that's the one that God's going to use to reach the entire town. We don't know. Again, remember, we get so caught up in it. Well, what's the right strategy? Or let's do this or that. But God wants us just to listen to him because he might use somebody like you to reach this town. And God can't use the pastor because his heart's too hard, like I said earlier. Maybe God wants to use you to reach everybody. Maybe God's brought you so low and to such a point because he wants to deliver you out and have you to have a praise and a testimony and say, hey, I was at the bottom. I tried it all, and I realized it's wrong. The answer is Jesus Christ. He touched my life. You know, I bet there was a totally different expression on this woman's face when she went running back into that town, as we're going to see next week. And they could see it. They saw the before. They didn't have to understand all the details of her life. They saw the before and the after, and they said, hey, there's something there we need. I wish I could see the look on her face when Jesus says, I am the answer, right here. She understood this place of honor. Paul understands it's all about Christ. Let's look at Philippians chapter 3, verse 8, as we're about to close here and wrap this up. Yea, doubtless I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ, Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered and the loss of all things, I do count them but dung. It's everything, all the things I've been through, it's all trash. That I may win Christ. That's the whole goal here. To be found in him, not having mine own righteousness, which is the law, but that which is through faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith. And in verse 10 it says, that I may know him. There's Paul. He's a great evangelist. He's been serving the Lord for a long time. But what does he want to do? I want to know Christ. If anybody could say, I know Christ in the past tense, Paul would be the one. But here he's saying, I want to know him deeper. And the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings being made conformable unto his death. What Paul's saying is, hey, I've got a long ways to go, people. Here's immature in Christ, and here's mature in Christ. A long ways to go. We've all got a long ways to go. All got to work on those areas that the Lord wants to work in our heart. And you know, that's how we get to know Christ. That's how you want to understand Christ, is start letting him work in your life. All of a sudden, it all comes clear. All of a sudden, you realize that love is endless. All of a sudden, you realize, wow, the mercy of God. And David talked about it in Psalm 51, the mercy of God. David didn't understand the mercy of God until, what? He sinned. There's a man after God's own heart. Not only did he commit adultery, but then he commits murder to cover it up. And he says, God is so merciful. Here I am, the most wicked man. I've done these great sins against God. But God still loves me. God still wants me. He's still there. He's still drawing me. He still wants to bring me back. Doesn't matter how low I've been or what I've been through. You know, how many times, you don't have to go out sharing the gospel too many times with various different people, and they'll say over and over, oh, God would never save me. I'm too wicked of a sinner. Say right back to them. Say, hey, it's the same thing for me. I'm worse. I've done it all. I'm just as wicked as you are. God reached into my life and touched me. This morning, let's remember, what does God want to deal with in your heart? We're about ready to close. Let's go to have everyone bow our heads. Dear Lord Jesus, it's not about me, it's about you. I pray, God, that you would be working in these individuals' lives. Lord, I just feel like I feel so inadequate to be able to preach your word. I feel like there's just no way my bumbling words can get through. But Lord, I'm relying on your Holy Spirit this morning. And Lord, if there's something in someone's life this morning that they need to repent of, that little door that you keep knocking on, that you keep calling through, that you keep sharing your love through, but they're just, it's closed up so tight, they don't want to open it up to you. They don't want to let you come in. There's too many hurts, too much pain, too much sorrow, too much grief. Lord, I pray this morning they'd open that door. We will never understand the love of God until we have accepted His mercy. God, I pray this morning that you would move on these people's behalf, move on my behalf. Show me your mercy and your love. God, I need it more than anyone else. I pray, Lord, that this morning that individual would repent, would open that little door and tear down the locks. Let you come in, start to clean and cleanse and change. Lord, I just pray, Lord, that you would work in these hearts. I thank God for these individuals who are here this morning. They're seeking. They want to know the truth. They want to see your face. They want to understand you in a deeper way. They wouldn't be here otherwise. There's enough things to do on a Sunday morning. And God, I pray that you reward them with that. That you would pour your grace out upon these people, that you would move on their behalf. Lord, I pray these things in your name. Amen.